Oh, baby. It is about to get started up in here. I'd like to welcome you to the Justin Masterson Show. I'm your host, Justin Masterson. Welcome to episode 7, but it's not just me. Oh, we got my guy, Matt Zappasodi.
What's up, Jay? How you doing over there?
Oh, man, you know.
Nasty.
I'm just having a great time. They say home is where the heart is. Especially with a little KEVI right here. KEVI was in town.
He stood us up.
He did stand us up, but he was in town, right?
He's a working man.
He is a working man. Like, he is on the grind, doing crazy stuff.
He's putting out an album in, like, 2 weeks. Like, it took him 2 weeks. So he's, like, start and finish in 2 weeks. I was just like, what? Are you talking about a song?
No, he's not just doing a song. He's doing the whole thing because he's pretty impressive. But before we get anything going, I have to give a little talk. So last episode, we had Chris Hebert, as I call him, H, on there.
Hebert.
And we might have referenced him as dad. And so because of that.
Or grandpa.
Or grandpa. But don't go too far with that. But because of that, his wife, Heather, you know, there was some alluding that maybe there was another name in there for her. And I just want to set the record straight that Heather is much younger than H. Mm. So although H is dad, Heather is not mom. So don't go trying to put that out there or anything like that. She is not that. And I needed to set the record straight because, I mean, whew, when we do this stuff live, Zappo.
Heather, we're not coming after you. No way.
No, not whatsoever. I love her dearly and appreciate her very much. And so don't get confused that she is extremely young and H is extremely old. So don't forget that when you come down to it. But I got my shout out today. Actually, somebody should have been working, but they weren't. And so she got number one. But I'm doing a top three today, Zappo, for the top three people to like it on Instagram.
Oh.
Because the first is back-to-back Chris Alash, because she's got nothing better to do that she decided she... I mean, teach your kids, Carissa. Don't just try and like my Instagram post. And then we got her daughter, actually, Avery, who was number two, who I think she should probably also, I don't know, be doing schoolwork or something like that would be my guess. But third, I'm going to put it in there, is my guy, Brady Carmen. He's one of our catchers, helps me out with some lessons too. And not only that, but I found out that Brady, one of the girls that he's giving some catching lessons to, was on Nadia's basketball team 2 seasons ago, little Bailey. So that's awesome that he's working with her. Great things when it comes down to it.
I don't think I've liked the Instagram page yet. So,
well, that's not good because you are a part of this and you're supposed to like these things when we're doing these things.
I'll do that.
Especially right now. I want to say also is that there are two nonprofits. Of course, when we bring the guest in, which is not yet, so don't get excited there. You guys can't see him, but he's ready. Like, Steve is ready to go. He's here. You're going to love him as much as I do too, but we're not bringing him in yet. and so with that, there's two nonprofits. You see it on the screen. One is Wayfinders and helping everyday leaders move into the future and make the greatest impact. They're trying to invite you to come and activate your purpose. Love them, doing incredible things. Brandon Faust, Matt Kurtz. We got Allison and Giles, also a part of the team, doing great stuff. So you can always check them out. But the other one is this Fair Warrior, and their goal is to connect men to Jesus, build relationships, and make disciples. And so they're doing really incredible things. I also am a part of that. Zappo also is the executive director for them. But there's a really huge first-time fundraising event that Fair Warrior is putting on, and it is called Behind the Mask. And if you want a great speaker, I am going to be one of the people speaking.
Boom. Drop that bomb. He might drop the mic too.
I don't know. I'm not the main guy. I'm one of the guys. We got Jeff Larkin, who has Air Force military background, who'll be there doing some speaking. And then Steve Weatherford, which was actually kind of funny today. I was meeting with my guy Seth, And I was like, yeah, we got Steve Weatherford. And he's like, who's Steve Weatherford?
Yeah.
I was like, yeah. He's like, was he a punter? And I was like, yeah, he was a punter.
See, he knew.
He did know. He did know. But he was like, why are we having a punter? And I was like, well, he's huge. Like, he's jacked out of his mind. And
he's cool.
And he's cool. And he loves Jesus. And so we love people that love Jesus.
Yes,
and
we do.
And he's going to talk. I'm going to talk. Jeff's going to talk. Zappa's going to be there. We're going to have tons of people. What's at the... Where's that?
Lucas Estate in Carmel, Indiana.
Ooh.
It's worth the drive. If you're not local, come on over. It's a fantastic venue. It's our first big fundraiser, so you'll see us mess it up and fumble through things.
Oh, yeah.
But
we're good at that.
It's going to be
That's what we do on the show, man. I mean, that's what happens here. We fumble and get back to it.
Are you saying we're going to do a live show while we're there?
Well, don't get me excited.
Okay.
I think we have to do other things, so I don't think it's going to happen.
We could do a pre-show? Can we do a pre-show?
Oh, there could be a pre-show that takes place. I don't know. We'll find out. But I will say this. If you look at the show notes, you will see a link to the events page for Behind the Mask. Check it out. It has a place for you to get tickets to. And so it's great. Sorry, I just chuckled because I looked down and saw that H was said easy Zappo when you were calling him Grandpa.
Hey, I actually saw Boss Man, and Boss Man was the one who identified, and I just repeated. So we see each other Friday nights.
Oh, that's right.
And in passing.
Oh, you see the chair bear, huh?
So I can't say it was mine. I just am repeating. I'm not going to get in the middle of the family feud.
Oh, man. Well,
come on.
Well, we got Valentine's Day tomorrow. So make sure you got some good things going, okay? Mm. Just a reminder to everybody. My wife told me not to get flowers. I could get her a card, but not flowers. Don't get her anything. That's what she said. And anymore, I know that she actually means it. So I'm not.
You don't have to read between the lines? I mean,
no.
It's just straight up. Don't give me some.
It is straight up.
Does she want chocolate?
Nope.
Does she want, I mean.
No. What she wants
a massage?
Yes, is a massage.
Okay.
Because I have good hands and not like, get your minds out of the gutter, people. Not one of those
massages. Your head's
like,
there. Nobody else.
Okay, my head was there. It's just my head. But hey, if anyone else was in the gutter with me, get your mind out of there. It is just a nice, wonderful push it through. I mean, I like to say I got some pretty good hands. You can ask some of my ball players too. I like to get their shoulders in the right spot in between time. I like to think that I'm helping them be better.
You blushing a little bit? No. Okay.
Oh no, I'm feeling good.
It just looks like I am because the red flag, but don't worry.
Oh man, I love it. So that's our reminder, and I also just want to remind people that here at the Justin Masterson Show, we exist to entertain, encourage, inspire, and maybe equip, or all those. We want to show that the normal guy has a story worth listening to, not just the famous ones.
Mm.
And so, and also just because I like doing it.
That's why you got me. Normal guy, famous
just,
one.
It's just exactly. Normal, famous,
yeah, right.
Normal. so we'll keep it on you.
Yeah.
But let me tell you this. You remember that time where they say kids say the darndest thing?
Yeah, isn't there like a show about
that? Yeah, there's a show about that. And I couldn't think of another way to put it, but when I was talking with the coaches, actually, my kids say crazy stuff too. But one in particular came out, one of the coaches. I'm going to keep some anonymity to it. I don't know. One of the coaches was talking about his son, and they were at a spot, and there was a lot of different people, and they were speaking different languages and all different types of stuff. And so the son just goes, Daddy, are they all talking in cursive?
Oh, cursive. That's good. I like it. Took me a second. I like that.
I do. It's interesting. And so, speaking of talking in cursive.
Oh, yeah.
We got my guy. Oh, Steve Padovani coming up to hang out with us this evening. Steve, what's happening, man?
What's up, Masty?
Oh, not much. You know, just having a great time playing a little Ship It Up to Boston. I don't know if it's loud to you guys, but it's loud
it's
in
blast.
My
ears. Does it get you fired up?
So talking in cursive, was that like a little shot at the Boston accent there?
Oh, I was just getting people ready for the fact that the
I'm gonna try to do my best. I'll try to clean it up a little bit.
You know, it's perfectly fine. I don't mind that that you got it going on. I enjoy it. I like it. It takes me back to some fun times in the good old days. So for the people who are like, who in the world do we have going on here? Because lately we've had some local people, some Fishers Tigers. But all the way from Massachusetts is where my guy Steve's coming from. We actually met. Oh, I don't know if it was the official first time we ever met. But I think we just met in the bullpen.
Yep.
At Fenway Park. Yeah, you know, since you're here. Yeah, you know, at Fenway Park with the Boston Red Sox. Because you were hanging out there as a part of the grounds crew, and it's also, you know, we had this theme out there that we were the Black Pearl. That was like the cool bring us all together type of Boston thing for the Red Sox. And I was a Jamaican Slingmon.
Yep.
And then we had our wonderful Smee.
Smee. That was me.
Smee doing the work.
I can see that.
I'm not sure if that was a compliment or not, but you know, I went with it.
I mean, coming from the bullpen coach, old Gary Tuck. You never know.
Gary Tuck, the Tuckster.
You know, shout out to Gary Tuck. I have no doubt that he is not watching this, but
you know, I tried to reach out to him. I actually still keep in touch with the Tuckster.
Yeah.
Tried reaching out to him, and after the show, I'll reach out to him again, and I'm sure he might take a peek.
He may.
He might take a listen.
I need to reach out to him again, too, because we talked a little bit, and then I get him at least once a year, which it should probably be a few more times than once a year, but it's not.
Yeah.
But we'll start with this. So we'll start with what I know, and what I know is we hung out at Fenway Park with the Boston Red Sox together, but actually before that, because he came through yours, we just saw that Corey Kluber announced his retirement.
Yeah.
Did you have any interaction with Corey Kluber? He was in Boston, right?
I did. You know, I heard so I'm pretty sure that Kluber's wife is from Winchester, Mass, which isn't far from where I live.
Yeah.
And my buddy actually is at my member of the Winchester Country Club, and I think Corey and his family are as well. So he kind of told me, he's like, Kluber's a great dude. You got to introduce yourself to him. And I did. And he is a really stand-up guy. Great guy.
That's nice.
Really, really well-liked. Everybody loved him.
Yes.
You know, so yeah, I actually did interact with him a little bit. Yep.
Well, and in honor of Corey Kluber retiring, I actually wore, this wasn't in Boston, but this was in Cleveland. I got the rally chicken. I don't know if you can see that very well.
Trying to figure out what that was. Yeah.
Yeah. So, Corey was really good at coming up with these little ideas in the background, and then I would be the implementer. And so he, and I don't know if this was exactly his idea or whose it was, but we had Cody Allen was our closer at the time. We'd call him Chicken Al, which the way that came was crazy, but we call him Chicken Al. And so we brought a live chicken, literally live chicken, to the field, and it was on a leash, and I don't know if it's Corey's idea, but I'll give it to Corey. And then I took it out to batting practice while they're out there and delivered it to Chicken Al so that he could have it around. And literally right after that, I'm pretty sure that was 2013, we won 10 games in a row and made the wild card game. And so these shirts by G&V Designs over there in Cleveland made a nice little cool rally chicken shirt.
Rally chicken.
Oh, man. Yeah, it was great. I loved it. But
did PETA get on you?
I don't know.
I mean, if you were humane and stuff.
Yeah, we didn't. I mean, we didn't sacrifice it like Joe Boo.
Okay.
I was actually going there. I was going to ask that. I'm glad you got to it first.
You know, it wasn't Major League, and we weren't sacrificing the live one. Yeah, we went and got some fried chicken somewhere else. But
yeah.
No, the live one was good enough, and it was perfect. But I will say, you know, off camera, we were talking a little bit, and, you know, we got to, I just, you know, you're bald, I'm bald, we have beards, lack of beards. I talked about my beard last time, and talking about kids asking us questions and kindergartners and whatnot. So are you, you're a bald guy, right?
Yeah.
How long have you been bald?
My wife kind of makes a big deal about it. She, you know, my wife says our kids will never know you with hair. And I don't really know what that means. Right. No. So I say that. I'm like, what does that even mean? She's like, I don't know. Sometimes I kind of wish she had like a full head of hair. And I'm like, it is what it is. you know, love me for who I am.
And I do. But how did you get to that? Because I was Mr. Clean for Halloween, so I chose to shave.
So, yeah, I had the receding hairline thing going.
You had it? It's not there anymore?
No, it's not.
I don't know. I don't let it. I shave it every day. I go every day. Yeah, there was a receding hairline, and then I kind of had to do it. And in college, I was, you know, like buzzed it down. Didn't really bick it. And now the last, I'd say 20, 25 years, I just bick it right down.
Oh, man. How old are you?
46.
Whoa. You are young. You are still very young. For everyone else who's watching, if you're 46 or under, you're very young. Just
no, I don't feel young. I do not feel young. I'll tell you that.
Oh, you don't?
At all. What? No.
I mean,
I wake up in the morning with these pains, and I'm like, where did this pain come from? I didn't do anything.
You slept.
I slept. That's it.
I get injured all the time sleeping.
Oh, I get out of breath tying my shoes. I walk up a flight of stairs. My students are like, Mr. P, why are you breathing so hard? I'm like,
well. We could work on that one. I mean,
I don't know what to tell you.
Well, let's go with this. So, I mean, because that you've been 25 years, is it like 25 years you've been at Fenway Park grounds crew? Or
yeah, this will actually be my 25th season coming up. Yeah.
I mean, tell me about how do you get into that? Like, what happened? So, like, how do you even do that? Because it's not your full time job.
Yeah, weird story. So as you know, I teach full time. So this is a part time job, but it ends up being a lot of hours. But I was just, you know, back in the day, I was working out at a local gym, and I ran into a guy there who worked for the Sox. And he was like, you know, we were small talking, and he was like, you know, what do you do for work? And at the time, I was just doing some landscaping. And he's like, oh, I know the head groundskeeper at Fenway. He's like, I work for the Red Sox. Would you ever want to jump in there? And I loved baseball, obviously. And I'm like, sure. I didn't know it would happen so fast. And I went in, like, I think a few days later, old legendary groundskeeper Joe Mooney at Fenway at the time, and he just threw the job at me right away. And I was like, next thing you know, I'm on the field at Fenway Park, and I'm, you know, pushing dirt around and mowing the lawn, I guess.
I mean, is that a dream? I mean, kind of was. I mean, probably not necessarily.
It was amazing. Yeah, I couldn't believe it.
I mean, you're a ball player. Time, yeah, you love baseball.
Yeah. And I mean, at the time, there was, you know, like Nomar Garciaparra, Pedro Martinez, and I was like, whoa, like up close and personal with these guys.
Can you say Nomar's name again, please? Just because.
Nomar Garciaparra.
Nomar Garciaparra. You can't even match that. Indiana.
I told you that the accent was going to be thick. I told you.
Indiana, don't do that.
Hey, y'all don't talk right.
Oh, no. Actually, we did get a lot when we were over there. They're like, what accent do you have? And and it was like, well, actually, because even the people on the news in the New England area speak more like me than like you.
Mm. Right. Oh, yeah.
That's good practice.
So I was just like, well, I sound like the people who do the news. Like, you're the one that has, but then they'd say, I have an accent. So it's craziness within that. But you're dropping all these names, like Nomar Garciaparra, and all these other guys. Like, did you have a chance to interact with these individuals?
You're throwing them ground balls in between. I mean.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny how it just kind of like, you know me, Massey. I'll talk to anyone and I'll meet anyone. So, you know, I've in my 25 years there, I've met a bunch of people, and I don't know, I get lucky sometimes. Like, I just get these, you know, the job comes with perks. And over the years, you know, I've been able to kind of help out in the clubhouse. And as you know, being out in the bullpen, I just get to know all those guys.
Yeah.
And I'm all about relationships, you know, and I love chatting with people, sometimes too much. I think sometimes the relievers look at me like, all right, Smee, settle down. We want to watch the game now, you know, because I'll talk. And then I just go to the fans and I start talking to the fans a little bit.
Yeah, I can imagine that some guys are better than others. Yeah. But who's been your favorites throughout this?
Justin Masterson.
Oh!
Hey!
Hey, Masty!
Hey, saying it right now. Thank you.
No, you were part of that special group, you know. I mean, I still keep in touch with Pap. Obviously, the one and only Jonathan Papelbon.
The lost boy.
Lost boy. Yep, he was the lost boy. Yeah. Bard.
Danny Bard.
Bardo's a great guy. His comeback, obviously, was incredible to see that.
For sure.
And then, you know, I keep in touch with guys like Johnny Lester. And obviously, Veritek, I see all the time. He's still part of the staff.
That's right.
And then good old Mani. How can we shout out to Mani?
Oh, shout out to the
best. Best to ever do it.
It's gonna offend somebody else, Armando Camacaro in Cleveland. But
yep.
I mean, Mani Martinez is by far the best bullpen catcher, all around human being.
American citizen now too.
Yes, American citizen. And he told me, so I have to tell the story because it cracks me up every single time. Whenever I think about him, you know, he's talking about when, you know, from Venezuela.
Yep.
And so when there was like craziness going on in Venezuela, he's back at home and he's pulling out in his car and somebody comes up and is like carjacking him, like right outside his house. I think the guy's got a mask on or something like that. So Mani, he gets out of his car. And he just, you know, is calm, cool, collective, which is not surprising with him. And he just he walks around. Well, he happens to have a gun in his around his ankle. So he turns around and then he pulls out the gun and he shoots the guy. I think it was in the leg or something like that. Turns out the guy was his neighbor. It was his own neighbor who was trying to carjack him.
Oh my gosh.
And so then he shoots him and then he's like, dude, what are you doing? And then I think he helps him out and tries to get him along the way. But Mike,
moral of the story, don't mess with Mani.
Oh my goodness. Don't mess with him. But you want to talk about a guy, rub up baseballs. He would throw BP all day, every day, play catch with every single person who needs to play catch with. And it's incredible. But he is best.
Long toss every day, throws to two groups. Catches every side session. He's amazing.
That's pretty
amazing. And I remind him every day because it really makes him feel good. His English has gotten way better. Imagine he's learning how to speak English from someone like me.
Oh, man.
I can't even speak English. Correct.
I mean, I think you.
Yeah, I mean, he's the best.
You're a teacher of some sort.
I try to be.
Oh, there you go.
But within that, so you're meeting all these people. I mean, is there any... What's the worst experience you've had as a part of the grounds crew?
The worst experience I've had.
Can you talk about it?
Yeah, I was just trying to like figure those stories out in my head. You put me on the spot. I act real quick.
I know.
I would say anything that, you know, involves like weather, you know, like, there are some games where rain delay after rain delay. And then once the game ends, we're there for a good hour to two after the game. So the turnaround time, sometimes I'll get home at 2 a.m, sleep for maybe an hour or two. And then I wake up at like 5:30 to teach. So, you know, we'll leave it to that. Weather's been the worst thing that's ever happened to me. And, you know, off the show, maybe we'll talk about some other stuff.
I appreciate that political answer. Very nice. Right. But what's been the best experience that you've had?
There's been so many, you know, like been blessed to be part, you know, four World Series championships, obviously. And those are incredible.
Four of them?
Four, yeah. 2004, 2007, 2013, 2018. Mm. Yeah, I wrote down in my notes here. It's funny. I mean, I think most people know this, but like from 2001 to 2018, so call it like 17 years, we had 12 parades in Boston. You know, there were six Red Sox, you know, there were six Patriots titles, four Red Sox titles, Bruins title, Celtics title. So, I mean, I don't think there'll ever be a stretch like that.
Now, is there a correlation that you've been on the grounds crew since then? And that's been, I mean, it sounds like you're the difference maker. I mean, I feel like that's where you were going. I was going to save you from being arrogant about it and just allow me to say it instead of, because I know that's exactly what you were saying. Like, Steve Padovani, I'm the reason. Steve Mario Padovani.
Mario. Hey, Mario. I think I am the reason. You know, I tell people that, but they kind of look at me like I'm a little crazy. They're like, you're not the reason. And I'm like, I know, you're right. I'm not the reason.
I mean, MLB players get, you know, scouted by other teams, they get, you know, offers. I'm assuming that the Patriots are knocking at your door. I'm assuming that the Bruins are knocking at your door. Like, hey, we need this mojo. Like, What do you say?
This guy. You want some energy? You want some energy? I'm the guy.
Do you even negotiate, or are you like, no, I'm off the table. I'm sold. I'm, you know.
Pretty much sold. At this point, I should probably get an agent to represent me.
Well, Justin's looking for a job, so.
I am. I could use a little extra income. I'd be more.
His percentage is not something that you'd want to deal with. But
actually, Masty, you know, no joke, we need some arms. We need some arms this year, so.
I don't know if you got something left,
come on over.
I don't know if there's much left in there. Maybe. It's been feeling good. I was just telling Poizel, one of our coaches.
Get down to Fort Myers. You know where we train. Get down there.
Whatever year it was when he went back, I didn't question it verbally. I didn't say, like, why are you going back? I didn't say, what was your offer? We were tight. I was working with Justin at the time. But he could tell that I was waiting for a response. And all I heard was Steve, but I didn't really know you. I didn't know what it meant. And here I am meeting you 10 years later, whatever, and this is why he went back to Boston.
This is it.
That's why. Now you have the answer. Now you have the answer.
It's amazing. The sole reason.
It's amazing. I think there's a song, Back to Boston, too, but I don't know if that was out yet. But
but it does make it great. But, you know, so, you know, you keep up with a lot of guys, which is really cool. But you're friendly, you're talkative, you've never met a stranger. I mean, has this always been you? Like, give me some background on Steve. Like, where do you come from? What has made you who you are and all that type of stuff?
Excuse me. Yeah, for sure. I mean, I've been told I'm really extroverted. You know, my wife, it drives my wife nuts. sometimes she's like, do you ever shut up? You know, I'm a morning guy, so like I'm up early in the morning, and when I'm up, you know, I want to wake the whole house up. So, you know, I'm the first one up, and my wife is like, what is wrong with you? What are you doing? Why are you making all this noise? What is going on? But yeah, that's always just been me, talkative.
I mean, that's part of your upbringing. I mean, is that like, you know?
Yeah. So I grew up, as I mentioned to you in the past, my parents were born in Italy, loud Italian household.
Hey, shout out. We got two Italians on the call right now. Like, I mean, it's crazy. We got a Zappasodi. We got a Padovani.
I'll adopt you any day.
I'll make the pasta. You come eat it.
Yes.
Give me a little fettuccine, maybe some white sauce.
How are we not drinking some vino right now as I know. We do this?
Oh, man. You know?
My house was loud growing up, very loud. And I was just kind of always talking, always moving, tons of energy. And that's who I am. Even in my classroom, you know, I think I drive some of my high school students crazy because, you know, they'll say stuff like, why are you so loud in the morning? It's first block of the day. Like, why are you buzzing around and all over me to do work and this and that? I'm just waking up. And that's how I am. I mean, I'm just kind of in your face. But I know it can be obnoxious sometimes, I'm sure.
Oh, I imagine. Did they like you in high school, or were you just, were you that guy? I mean, I feel like.
I like to think I was that guy that they liked and not that guy. Cause I've been told to, like, you know, don't be that guy.
Huh. I've heard that before.
Hope I wasn't that guy, but.
I was just always alive.
Always a lot of energy, always talkative. And I guess that's why I like teaching as well. You know, I love being up in front of the class and moving around and, you know, with being able to coach as well. It's just a lot of fun to bring a lot of energy. I get my energy from people.
Yeah.
You know?
What are you teaching? I mean, I know you've been a teacher all the time. That's why it's always weird. I'm like, wait, you teach and you come out here and you're at Fenway Park, and how in the world does all that work? Because, I mean,
it's a lot.
You gotta be teaching.
It's a lot, you know, like my day starts at 5:30, get out. I like to get to school real early. Our school day doesn't start till 7:45, but I'm usually there by like 6:45-ish. I like to get settled. I drink a lot of coffee, which I don't know if that helps.
You got to let the people know. Steve is here. Mr. P is in the house.
Right, in the house. But I don't know. I guess I don't require a ton of sleep. You know, I can come home and just get a couple hours of sleep, and then I just get up and do it all over again.
So what are you teaching? Math, social studies, science? You're definitely not a science teacher.
No, I'm not a math science guy at all.
Yeah. Me either.
Oh, my God. Some of my students, you know, some of my high school students take, you know, I'm okay with, like, Algebra 1, Geometry, Algebra 2, okay, but then some of them take, like, AP Stats, AP Calculus.
Oh, man.
Mm. It's like a foreign language. It looks like German to me.
Are they speaking cursive? Is that?
Yeah.
Speaking cursive, right. but, yeah, so I've taught special education. I guess I've always been, like,
okay.
I've always been into kind of, you know, kids who struggle to learn a little bit.
Yeah.
And right now I'm in a unique position. I run it's called the Academic Center. I teach in a small town north of Boston, right on the water. Little shout out. It's called Manchester by the Sea.
Oh,
the town that I teach in.
Isn't that a movie? Wasn't that a movie or something?
Yeah, movie. Yeah, the movie was actually filmed there. Yeah.
Oh, it's named after your city. Wow.
Yeah. So it's a regional school, Manchester and Essex, and grades 9 to 12. And I run an academic center. So it's for kids that, you know, struggle with executive functioning, which is just a fancy word for organization.
I was going to say, can you dumb that down for us over here?
But what's cool about the program is about 25 kids in our program. And there's an adjustment counselor attached to it as well, because most of the kids have some type of, you know, social emotional component. And that's, I think, what I love most about teaching is over the last few years, there's been a huge emphasis on mental health.
Yeah.
And I that's what I've really embraced and really love. I really love that because I wear multiple hats, you know, every day. A lot of my kids don't necessarily need a ton of help academically, but it's just, you know, social, emotionally, they can become quite dysregulated. So I just love being a positive role model, trusted adult in their lives.
I mean, that's pretty impressive. Like to do that. I like to talk about a lot in life on the show, you know, trying to gain a greater maturity in the way that we do things, which my definition of maturity is the ability to handle the big emotions that come your way.
Yep.
And to still act like yourself in the midst of those. Right. And so it's like, that's exactly, you know, the same concept, in that overall sense of what you're trying to instill in these young guys. Like, what, again, what's your style? What's your way? Like, how are you doing this? Why are you doing this? What's the implementation? Like, this is just, it's just weird. I mean, I know you love people, but like,
yeah, no, I would say so. So when I graduated, from, Northeastern University,
Can I give you one little thing? Shout out Northeastern. And old Steve-O here, Mr. Smee, did play baseball there. He's rocking it right there. I was looking at – I was disappointed that in their stats archives, it only goes back to 2001. But I was able to find – it was either 99 or 2000 that you were batting 311. You got in 27 games. Starts, 47 games or something like that, or 67. I don't know what it was.
I was just a glove guy. I could run, believe it or not. I hit leadoff. I could run.
Believe it or not.
And I loved playing defense, but I...
He's a little stocky, you know?
They buried me in the nine. Let's just say they buried me in the nine hole. Like, I was just...
Second base? Where were you on the field?
Second base. Yes.
Seeing men after my own heart.
I played shortstop. I played shortstop in high school. Mm.
You Italians.
You know, I got recruited by some bunch of Division I schools, and they were like, I'm not quite sure you have the arm strength to play short at the D1 level. I'm like, okay, how about the other side of the bag? And they were like, sure, let's give it a shot.
5'9", 5'10", how tall are you?
That's 5'8".
My license says 5'9". My wife says I'm like 5'7".
Yes. Yeah. I agree with your wife.
Yeah.
Love you.
Yeah, when I stand next to Masti, my God, it's like Jose Altuve next to like Aaron Judge.
Yeah. I mean, you can see how he put his screen right now. He put the camera so that he looks nice and big on camera. I mean, I'm sure that was on purpose.
I actually did do that.
Love it.
Oh, I had no doubt.
Yeah, but just get back to Northeastern real quick. Shout out to NU Baseball. Mike Glavin's actually their head coach, real good friend of mine, Tom Glavin's brother.
Okay,
And they're coming into the season, opening up Friday night, ranked first time ever, like top 25 in the nation. They won 44 games last year.
Oh, wow.
And I think they're ranked like number 23 in the nation coming in. So.
Wow, that's awesome. They couldn't have done it without you. Again, we're seeing this. Mm-hmm. You're going to have to come be a part of whatever I'm doing.
Well, I am involved. I actually, for the last 20 years, You wouldn't be surprised. I actually run their youth, the Northeastern Baseball Youth Camp over the summer.
Oh, okay.
So I'm like kind of in charge of that thing. Wow. Believe it or not, they kind of put me in charge of it. And so I'm really involved still with Northeastern, and I love that, everything about that place.
So what degree did you get from there?
So I was, you know, I'm all over the place here. So I was talking about when I graduated, I actually had my major was psychology and I minored in sociology. So then after I was like, what am I going to do with this? And I had a buddy who was a high school teacher, and he's like, you know, you love coaching. He's like, why don't you get into teaching and just see if that'd work for you, you know?
Yeah.
So I did. And I should say, after I got done playing at Northeastern, I coached there full time for 4 years. Mm. So I was just coaching, you know, out of college. And then I, you know, got my master's in education, became a teacher, and here I am close to 20 years later teaching, and I love every minute of it.
So you've had the experience with the youth, you've had experience with the college guys and the MLB guys. I mean, really, you're just naturally coaching them. You know, you're in the bullpen, right?
Yes.
So you're getting all sorts of characters out there.
Oh, characters, for sure.
And then, you know,
great,
a lot of guys.
Great way to put it.
A lot of guys get called up. Their first spots are out in the bullpen coming in. And so, in a way, you're Papa, your coach. I mean, this is like, hey, this is my world. Like,
yeah. And I imagine they walk into the bullpen and I run right over them. I'm in their face. They're like, who the heck is this guy?
They're speaking
like,
cursive.
They're like, who's this guy that takes care of the mound and the plate, pushes the dirt around, but then he just doesn't stop talking?
Love it.
He's going and going. The Energizer Bunny, when it comes down to it.
You're like, hey, can you show me that grip? I mean, I'm trying to learn a little bit here and tweak that a little bit.
No, it's a lot of fun out there, though, because, you know, I've learned over the years, obviously, and Massey, you remember this, like early on in the game, first couple innings, you know, it's light, it's loose. And I kind of, you know, read their body language too. And then as the game progresses and, you know, they get up and start warming up, I try to zip it. I kind of go in the corner and just
stare at the wall,
talk to myself because there's nobody else to talk to.
Phony phone call it. Hey, honey, I'm just here working. Like, you can't talk to anybody. You know, put it down.
Oh, yeah. Too funny.
She just ignores the call every time.
Oh, without
she does.
A doubt.
All
I'm
the
sure
time.
She does. But let's, so you got all that. You're helping out young guys through there, but we still haven't yet got to, like, why? Like, what's the reasoning, the purpose you're deciding to be impactful? Like, we know you're outgoing, talk to everybody. That's the Italian in you. That's, you know, that's God given, born with. But like, to just go and say, you know what, I'm going to work with people who need not even just academic help. They need life help. And I mean that, yeah, that's a part of the coaching, but most people can't handle their own emotions well enough to be able to sit in there. So like, how do you do it?
I think this is going to be a little bit of a complicated answer. So
I like having
two daughters and, you know, being Italian, I'm an emotional guy. I really am. And I always, my wife and I always talk to our daughters about the importance of being comfortable expressing your emotions. Mm. And I guess, you know, I identified, you know, high school age kids, call it 14 to 17 or 18. I think that's a really vulnerable time in your life. You know, I think that every day when I walk into my school, I kind of see kids who think they have it figured out, but a lot of them are just, they're kind of lost. You know, they're not quite sure who they are, kind of searching for who they are, who their friends are.
Yeah.
And the more I do it, the more I love, you know, trying to just play a small part in being a trusted adult and letting them know that, you know, to be honest, I don't really care about the A's and the B's in chemistry or biology or history or whatnot. I want them to be healthy kids, you know, and by healthy, I mean, not only academically, but most importantly, social emotionally, and being in check with their emotions. And, you know, if they need assistance, right, being able to come to me to talk about anything. And I've had some heavy conversations with students, students that have, you know, trusted me so much, where I've heard stuff like, I want to give one shout out, probably the most impactful, inspirational student I've ever had. She's probably, I won't name drop on this one, but she's probably late 20s right now, mid 20s.
Okay.
Crushing life as a nurse down in Florida.
Oh, nice.
But she came to me one day and she was really upfront about everything. Hated school, kind of a tough family at home. And she came to me one day and she told me that she was addicted to fentanyl. And she had been abusing drugs for over a year. In the meantime, she lost her mom from cancer, and she was just a complete mess.
Wow.
And I stood by her side, and to be honest, I listened to her. We definitely butted heads. We had our battles, but I stood by her side and probably gave her the most meaningful hug I've ever given any student when she walked across the stage and graduated. And she was in and out of rehab. And she's been sober 6 years now.
Wow.
Crushing life, super inspirational.
Yeah.
We text probably, multiple times per week. She's just checking in. She wants to see pictures of the girls. She wants to see the girls when she comes home. And she has been huge, and she's taught me so much about teaching. And I promised her that I would kind of talk about her a little bit tonight, because she said when she goes and speaks all over the United States, she said she always talks about me and says the words that this guy saved my life. So I don't do it for that reason, but obviously that's like the type of impact you can have on a kid's life.
Yeah. I mean, that's
inspiring.
Yeah. It
is. Yeah. Yeah. So, and it's just the kids that, they need you more than you think, so they'll come in and talk about things from, even have a lot of athletes, kids will come in and say, Mr. P, can we talk to you about my playing time in basketball? Like, I'm thinking about quitting. So it's those types of conversations that I love about teaching, caring about the entire student and seeing them go, from an immature freshman to then graduating. And then, some of them are college bound. Others might go into the military, but I just like to keep in touch with them after they graduate to just make sure they're doing well,
Now, how do you deal with, because I always love it when it's, you get to see them change and adjust and do some incredible stuff, but it always gets on me, like, how do you handle the ones that got away, for lack of the better way of putting it?
Yeah, that's a great question. That one kind of like, those beat me up a little bit. You know what I mean? Like, the kid obviously has to be receptive to the support, right? So, and we need, there's different team members involved in the equation, right? So like their home life parental support is huge too. So sometimes we have some parents who might not be on board with what I'm trying to teach them at school. So that can be a little difficult. But it just all depends on their maturity. Some kids get it early, some kids get it later. Other kids don't get it until after they graduate, and they might come back and visit. And, I've had a few say, Mr. P, like, oh God, the stuff you were trying to teach me, like, I was too immature then,
right?
But now I kind of get it.
Yeah. I like those ones.
right. But I mean, I think that's what just drives me so much is I love – every day, you just don't know what type of attitude they're going to come in with. Tomorrow morning, I'll show up at, 6:45, 7 o'clock in the morning, and students like to come in early, and they kind of just like congregate and hang out in my,
of course,
my room. We have like a little morning meeting thing. But I love that, and you never quite know what to expect. Yeah. And to be honest, my school day flies by because I'm just like moving around and I'm so into what I'm doing, so invested in them.
Now, what do you do to keep yourself from getting so frustrated? I mean, like you were talking about the inspiring story of the young girl who's a nurse now, who goes around speaking, telling her story, who's been sober for the longest amount of time now, 6 years.
Yep.
And yet you were butting heads in certain moments.
Yeah.
And you're stinking Italian. So you know that like your natural giftedness is like,
yeah,
well, I'm just going to slap you and punch you in the face, and then we're going to figure it out later, and it's nothing personal. But you can't really do that in that setting. So how do you take what's like, some God-givenness of that emotional excitement and be able to what do you do with it?
It's tricky. Like, it takes an enormous amount of patience, you know, and I try to, you know, even that particular girl in the moment when she was dysregulated in school, like, she would say some pretty nasty things to me, right? And I knew she didn't mean those things. But in that moment, I just had to kind of show some poise and composure.
How do you do it? How do you do that to show that poise and composure? I mean, you do it. Is it just
deep breath, lots of prayer? That guy upstairs, lots of prayer. No, my wife always says, she's like, you're so patient with your students. She's like, how come you have no patience with me and our daughters?
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. You're different. But I mean, it takes a lot of composure in that during that time. Cause there are moments in my day where like my head feels like it's going to just explode, you know, especially now. I don't think there's ever been a more challenging time to not only raise kids, but be a teacher. Mm-hmm. You know, we have a ton of, so my school district is super tiny town, super affluent, really powerful parents. And, you know, we have a huge problem right now kind of with like some anxiety and just overall mental health and of late some school avoidance. So kids just not wanting to come to school for various reasons, okay. You know, and to be honest, sometimes it's, you know, our kids have a lot of pressure on them. You know, we have, I think we have like close to 300 public school districts in Massachusetts, and the particular school I teach in, our district is ranked like in the top 5 or 10 in the state. So, you know, it's a really high performing district. And with that comes a lot of pressure. So our kids are faced with tons of pressure.
Right.
And sometimes they crack, you know, mm-hmm. and they break and it'll turn into, I don't want to go to school. And a couple days turns into weeks, might turn into like a hospitalization. And then all of a sudden, you know, you have a pretty complex situation on your hands.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, it's challenging right now because, you know, there is such a big social emotional component to high school kids. And with my own daughters, obviously my oldest is in middle school, sixth grade, and I'm starting to see it with her, you know, her friends and, you know, a little bit of a change in attitude and whatnot.
Oh yeah, it's about the right time.
Yeah, it's about that time. She's starting to wear the makeup a little bit. You know, she's thinking she's too cool for school.
Is she doing her morning routine? I mean, my girls are doing their morning routine.
They do it on me. Actually, they did some on me before my appearance time.
Nice.
So yeah, they're at Sephora all the time. They're doing this morning skincare and nighttime skincare and all that stuff. But it's, you know, it comes with, you know, getting back to that, comes with a lot of pressure. And I think, you know, like I said, my school district does a really good job of focusing on that mental health component in school.
Now, it continues to make me think, you see the kids and you're around them a lot. I'm around a bunch. Zappo's around a bunch, whether through coaching, hanging out, all that type of stuff.
Yeah.
And yet you see the kids who have these struggles. And then I go look at the parents, though, and the parents are not great at doing it whatsoever either. You know, you talk about avoidance. They're avoiding certain things they don't want to do. They're hiding. They're probably the ones putting the pressure half the time. Like, yes, absolutely. The kid wants this. Because I was talking to my daughter. You know, she got a, you know, B- on her test.
Yeah.
And, you know, she happened to study some of the wrong stuff, you know, is what ended up happening. But I was like, I mean, we got a friend over in West Lafayette who's trying to show that like C's are average, like not like let's everyone get a C, but C's are average. Like B means you're, B's are better, you know, more above average, and then A's are like, yeah, you're up here. And it doesn't mean we don't strive for it, but we, like you said, that pressure which is there, but then it continues to go on because it's not. You don't feel that I'm loved just because of who I am, but based off of what I do. And so then that sets us up for, I mean, terrible things altogether. Because whether that's in our faith, in life, with our people, the expectation is that I have to do something in order to earn some type of recognition or love. And yet it's like, no, you're loved and cared for just the way you are.
Right.
It doesn't mean you don't strive for something better. It doesn't mean we're trying to adjust some of our ways to get better, to create better habits. But But because you do more doesn't gain you more love. It shouldn't gain you more love in the eyes. Yeah. And yet that's the thing that happens. So that just fires me up a little bit. So I can appreciate
it. Yeah, it fires me up almost every day at school. You know, we have a lot of students who want to take honors and AP classes, you know, because mom went to Harvard, dad went to like Columbia, you know, and they feel that pressure of like, oh, I need to be like my mom or like my dad. And, you know, when push comes to shove, I love having that honest conversation with the student and sitting them down alone and saying like, why you don't like science? Why are you taking AP bio? Why? And they're like, oh, cause I have to. I'm like, no, you don't have to. Oh, but my mom and my dad say I have to. If I want to get into, you know, Dartmouth, I have to. And there lies the problem, right? Mm-hmm. Like, same thing with my daughters. You know, they'll come home and say like, oh, daddy, I didn't do so well on the test. And I obviously ask her about it. And did you study and whatnot? But at the end of the day, my wife and I always say like, honey, it's okay. It's okay that you didn't do so well.
Right.
You know, that's okay. That's part of life.
It is. You're going to fail. I mean, in some way, shape or form, no matter if you're the best of all things, you're going to mess up. Or, as you said, you're going to start avoiding. Because you're
like, avoidance is huge right now. Right now with my high school kids, it is probably crazy. The number one coping strategy they have is avoidance.
Interesting. I never would have thought that. I mean, you see all different other crazy stuff that's happening and going on, but it makes total sense because you don't want to be seen as a, I mean, in some way, you don't want to be seen as a fraud. Like, I've set all this up, and so now I don't want you to see me, you know, as a fraud in the mix of this. So it's crazy. But shoot, man, we could talk. We're gonna have to have you back on the show again at some point.
I would love it, man. You know that. You don't have to ask me twice. I would love that. I'm looking at the time and I'm like, oh my God, I'm gonna keep these guys on till like midnight.
It's fine.
This is why my wife said this. Massey, know how much you talk.
Yes. Yes. You tell her and she's listening. Yes, I do know, and I knew. That's what I was telling Zappa before we got on. I said he is an excellent conversationalist and we're gonna be great. But before we get out of here, I do want to hit on this because it affects, you know, my life, your life, and I don't know the whole totality of the story. You know, I know, you know, bits of it when we were going, but today is the 13th?
13th.
13th. So yesterday, you know, we celebrated. It's been, I think, 6 years since my father-in-law passed away, and so always, you know, a tough day for my wife and, you know, my mother-in-law and you know, my brother-in-law and family and all that type of stuff. Because it's difficult to lose a family member in the midst of it. And I know that that's some of your story. I don't know if you want to share a little bit about that, because I know people listening who they've lost, you know, parents here and there. And I don't know.
Yeah. I would love to, actually. And it kind of ties in something I know you're passionate about is faith. So my mom and my dad were my everything. They raised my brother and I the right way, and we were very fortunate. Unfortunately, my mom passed very young. She was only like 63 from cancer after a battle with cancer. My oldest daughter, Mia, was 10 months old at the time.
Okay.
So my wife and I moved in with my dad and Mia in my childhood home because my dad didn't really know how to do anything on his own. He was an old school Italian dude. My wife is like, we got to move in with him. He's not going to be able to survive. So we moved in with him. Just to talk about my dad real quick.
Yeah.
He was my hero, my idol growing up. He was an airborne ranger in Vietnam, Bronze Star, Purple Heart, over 100 jumps in combat. Mm. I mean, he was just a ridiculous athlete, Hall of Famer in high school. Amazing, amazing human. Ava was three, my second youngest daughter. Ava was 3 days old, and we brought her home from the hospital. And that next morning, we were up all night with Ava being so young as an infant. I said, I want to go, you know, Dunkin' Donuts and get coffee, whatever. So I went downstairs into my basement to ask my dad if he wanted a coffee as well. And I couldn't find him down there. So I came upstairs and I said to my wife, oh, my dad must have gone out to get coffee already. And he's like, Steve, no, he didn't. I didn't hear the garage door, any door open. But I went back down and I found my dad dead. He passed from a heart attack. So now my wife runs down the stairs and she has, not to get too dark here, but she has, you know, a 2-year-old and a 3-day-old in her arms.
Right.
And, you know, she's watching her husband trying to bring his dad, you know, back to life. So in that moment, I froze, and I honestly, I didn't know how life was going to go on. I'm like, how am I going to raise two kids, you know, without parents? Like, why is God doing this to me? What is going on? And I, to be honest, I felt bad for myself. I'm like, why me?
Right.
Well, little did I know that that would be the most powerful and inspirational thing that ever happened to me. You know, everything I do today is for my daughters and for my wife, but I feel like my parents are right there over my shoulders watching every single move. They're my, you know, my inspiration. And, you know, I feel like that story, I try to share that story sometimes, not to make it all about me, but with my students who are going through some trauma in terms of, you know, a loss of loved ones, I say you can be stronger because of it.
Yeah.
And a lot of times they'll come back, could be years later, and they'll be like, Mr. P, you were right. Like, I gained strength from that. And the main reason I gained that strength to be able to move on was definitely from the Lord. You know, I love to go to church. I pray every single night. And I feel like, you know, there's a reason why good things have happened to me and my wife and my daughters. And a big part of that is the Lord above. So, you know, that's the reason why we're, you know, we're so faithful. Religion's played a huge part in my life. My parents taught me that growing up, and that's kind of my story, not to end it on a little bit of a downer there, but,
that's
my reality now, you know, it's my reality.
It picks it right back up where it needs to, because it gives such a perfect understanding of life. I mean, in the sense of it, you have these, you know, kids that you're dealing with going through crazy stuff, and you have these parents who raised you in the right way, and then you, of course, you lose them earlier than what seems right to have it, and yet God's able to make that an impactful thing in your life to continue your purpose and all that type of stuff. But even greater, it is, you know, good things that happen, but it's crazy because this is hitting in my life and some other people's life too. Is that, man, we've been doing great things, faithful to the Lord.
Yep.
And yet there have been, you know, certain things that haven't gone well. You know, there's some, you know, financial pieces over here that aren't as pretty as I'd like, and these other things. But when I step back to look at it and go, yeah, but if I were hoping blessings to be in the spot they're supposed to be, which would be in my family, like, it is incredible what I'm seeing. You know, the growth in my kids and my wife and the relational capacity that we have with each other and the things that we're doing is monumentally greater than it's ever been in the entirety of our relationships. And yet there's other things that are tough within it. Like that's incredible. So that to me is just the positive story that comes through, that it's not always beautiful. It's not great to lose, you know, one, you know, much less both parents early, especially having two kids under the age of two, and even your wife to come and see that and her heavy heart that's for you in the midst of all that, and yet her to still be strong, because I know she's way stronger than you are.
Way stronger than me. ten times the athlete I was, way stronger than me.
Oh, without a doubt. And that it is neat that the way that God works, and you got some who would be like, it's random happenstance, but we know for certain that God is amazing and incredible, and we wouldn't be able to be here without him. And I know
I try to focus, you know what it is, Massey, I try to focus on, like, but even when it comes to special education, like, focus on the ability, not the disability, you know, like with my daughters, I'm like, let's focus on what we have versus what we don't have. You know, and sometimes it's hard to practice that, you know, but I tell my wife sometimes, like, when the kids are in bed, we'll look at each other and I'll be like, they're happy, they're healthy, you know, they love playing sports, they love going to school, you know, we show them a healthy, comfortable home and what the family means and what being faithful means. There's really nothing more than that.
No, you know. Well, because the backdrop of life, the way God wired us, is to be run off of joy. And right? I go off of this all the time. And joy is that deep-seated contentment. Somebody's happy to be with me. It's not just the happiness. It's that deep-seated relational capacity. And right? That is the marker that takes us to the next phase of where we're trying to go. And that's the way, you know, God's wired us and what we're trying to do. And so when we're able to sit within that joy and really have that,
yeah,
that's what takes us. And one of the first ways to get into that is appreciation, right, which is literally what you just talked about, where you're just sitting back and like, I'm not thinking about all the negative stuff.
Nope.
What can I appreciate about what's taking place in my life, or what is taking place, or what's going to take place? And it's amazing at how that changed my life. It's not just the power of positive thinking, even though that is great, but it's deeper than that because there's that relational joy that comes with it.
Yep. You nailed it.
Oh, man. I love it. Zappo, you got anything to say over there?
Man, sorry, this has been fun.
Zappo, we've been doing too much talking. I feel bad for you.
Right now, I'm thinking of you waking up Saturday, Sunday morning, depending on your routine. You're getting the pasta sauce going. You're getting, making the meatballs.
And the smell of the olive oil with the onions, like the beginning of the sauce. Oh, my God.
Yeah. And I'm next time I'm in Boston, I'm coming over. So
you got to come over. You got to meet up.
It's been a pleasure listening and getting to know you.
I appreciate it, man. I really do.
Joy from within and talk about inspiration about your parents and siblings. Hey, we're all here just for a short time, right? And so
that's right.
You can't avoid it. It's happening. Right. So you might as well learn from it and bring some good people with you. And it sounds like you're killing it.
Appreciate it, man.
Love it.
Well, I appreciate it. Thanks for having me, Masty.
I mean, usually we kick it out with my moto, big and chunky. But for the sake, since we're talking about Boston, we're going to get a little bit of a seventh inning stretch.
That's right.
Sweet Caroline. But on behalf of Steve, Mario, Padovani, Matthew, Arthur Zappasodi, Justin Daniel Masterson. We're here at Indie Pod Labs in Indianapolis. It's been fun. Hope you enjoyed it. A little bit of playfulness, a little bit of depth. I don't have the words for it. Thanks so much, Steve, for being here. We're going to have you again. We just got to go.
Thanks for having me, guys. I really appreciate it.
Enjoy the music.
Who'd have believed you'd come along? Touching hands, reaching out, touching me, touching you.